So recently, there was a study that said that TV viewing can raise white boys' self-confidence, but harm the self-esteem of girls and African-American boys. You know, is that news to you, or?
It's surprising. It's surprising, and then it's not surprising. Listening to that, you think once again of the doll test. And the first doll test was used to help the Brown versus Board of Education decision get passed. Then someone did the test again not too long ago. The results were the same. Now, this study you're mentioning that CNN says TV watching, same results. White folks, white kids, high self-esteem. Children of color, low self-esteem. What's happening? Maybe this all alludes to what I talk about when I address the issue of technology. It's still there.
But what was it like when you were growing up?
Great question. I wanted to talk about that because, oh, let me reach over here. I brought these guns here.
Oh, boy.
Can you see this? This is one of the things. When I found this under my Christmas tree, I was one excited little happy fella. This is the Fanta 50 shooting shell. You can't get a gun like this because it's so realistic. It actually shoots shells. And the realism in this is just fantastic. When we would play Cowboys and Indians, no one wanted to be the Indian, but we played Cowboys and Indians and we would see who had the quickest draw. I think the shooting show, that may have been a consequence where we always wanted to say, I got you. No, I got you. I was faster than you. Well, maybe the fact that the gun could project a shell, someone could get hit and you could say, see, I got you, you know. I brought this to make a point. When I was growing up, I was bombarded with images of white heroes. Growing up during the 50s, I still went to the movies, but the thing that had an impact on movie watching was television. Television was the thing. Cowboy movies came to TV. The person who helped bring that about was William Boyd. He bought up the rights to his feature films when he played Hopalong Cassidy. They brought that to TV. They would cut them up, feature films, little segments. He would do voiceovers because the thing is, TV was so new, they didn't even have product. And he made millions because he had something to bring to TV for people to watch. The other thing that was big for him to make money, the tie-ins, you know? So one of the things we wanted as kids is the Hopalong Cassidy bike. There was always the guns you wanted like your heroes. And so the Western hero, I grew up, you ask anyone who grew up as a baby boomer during the 50s, you can ask any of the old timers, they'll tell you, man, we wanted to be like Wild Bill Hickok, Johnny Mac Brown, Alan Rocky Lane, Don Red Berry. The Cowboys I grew up on, these shows, you rarely saw blacks in these films. And the thing that brought this to the forefront, there's an old expression, admission by omission. The admission was black cowboys did not exist. By omitting them in the features we saw, well, right away, the conclusion we drew was, well, there were no black cowboys. There were black actors in Westerns, but they weren't playing heroes. They were servants. Comic relief.
Where are the other boys, Picky?
They down the street, Mr. Jack, gunning up a load of them hotcakes.
Our new assignment is in Gold Springs. Ever hear of it?
No, sir. I'll find it. When do we leave?
You leave right away, with my horse. The boys and I will come on the morning stage.
Mr. Jack, is it all right if I take Bessie?
Sure, Pinky, go ahead and take her. She might come in handy.
Then I'll start riding right away.
Oh, and Pinky, don't forget our old rule. Keep your mouth shut.
Yes, sir. Mum, mum!
As far as black images, one of the most popular black actors you would find in these films, Republic put a lot of Westerns out, Republic films. And the one black actor I said was cinema's most prolific colored cowboy was an actor by the name of Fred Snowflake Toombs.
Oh, Snowflake?
Yeah?
Take my horse, Sonny, down to the blacksmith shop and have him tighten that front shoe.
Yes, and then what do I do?
Well, then you come back here and do whatever Mr. Anson tells you.
Yes, sir.
You're working for him, ain't you?
Yes, sir, I should.
Now, Snowflake, you would see him in a lot of Don Red Berry's films. And he was a typical black, along the lines of a step and fetch it, but someone, the stereotype was he's afraid of his own shadow, afraid of ghosts, and if danger was threatening him, they were quick to pull out a rabbit's foot.
Land of the living, why did I ever leave Birmingham?
The old stereotypes. That's what the black characters, that's the role they served in these Westerns.
Uh-oh. See what I see? Karen. Hey, hey, out here, Albert. Come on. Yeah, come on, take it. Boy. Here's one to you, too.
What are you doing? Stealing them carrots?
No, sir. I ain't stealing nothing. I just borrow them, that's all.
Well, you're gonna borrow some lead. Put them back there.
You wouldn't regret the horse and the mule and even myself of a carrot, would you?
You know what we do with thieves down here?
No, sir.
We hang them.
By the neck?
Yeah. Until you're dead.
Here's the reason why you couldn't have a black sidekick. See, a white sidekick can give you comic relief, but there are times when he can also come to the support of the white hero. You know, in other words, he could pull a gun on the villain, maybe help fight the villain. You couldn't have that with a black sidekick. It was very problematical because, as I mentioned in an earlier segment, you could not have a black strike a white. So if you're going to have this black sidekick at that time, especially during the 40s, how are you going to show him showing any kind of defiance against a white guy, even if he's a white villain? And that problem was very pronounced in a film called Haunted Gold. We had Blue Washington appear with John Wayne in around 1932.
Keep him up, Ryan.
Boss, that's our money that done helped me up.
I know it. That's why I sent you for it.
Oh.
Get their guns.
Yes, sir.
Put them in the water barrel, Clarence.
Yes, sir.
Come on, get moving there, Clarence. Throw them in.
But they hurry up and turn that around, and next thing you know, the villains turn the tables, and they're telling Blue Washington, okay, Smokey, get your black get out of here.
Hey, fellas, that looks like a mine tunnel. Get that lantern and bring that darkie.
All right, Mac, you and Bud stay and watch him. Bring him along.
Come on, get
get on down there and keep on moving.
Lord, you know what you done for Daniel. See what you all can do for me.
Move on, Smokey. Quit stalling.
Growing up on this imagery, where we just have the white heroes, as a kid, I didn't have what a lot of kids didn't have, and that's what we call adult discount. Adult discount is, you would hope most adults will, in their adult ages, have learned enough to know right from wrong, and at least know, hey, that's not quite accurate historically. The adult discount that we didn't have was that when I'm a kid, I didn't know if I'm watching some of my favorite white Western heroes, like Nick Adams when he plays the Rebel. I didn't know what the hell a Rebel was. So when the show was coming on, I'm sitting down rooting and singing along with the theme song. Johnny Yuma was a rebel. He roamed for the, you know? What the hell is a black kid doing rooting for a rebel? You follow what I'm saying?
Rebel being a Southern Confederate soldier.
Someone who really didn't want the Yankees telling them how to treat their black slaves, okay? Or Jim Bowie. Jim Bowie with the Bowie knife. He was a slave owner. Yancey Derringer, Jock Mahoney, he also had an Indian sidekick, Yahoo. Loved me some Jock Mahoney. He was like, what was unique about Jock Mahoney, he was a stuntman. He made people like Errol Flynn and Randolph Scott and Charles Starrett look great because he was the stuntman for these guys. But he played Yancey Derringer, and Yancey Derringer, his family were Louisiana slave owners.
Obadiah.
Marsh Yancey.
Obadiah.
Oh, Marsh Yancey. I've been praying for the time I set my eyes on you again. For years, we thought you was dead and buried.
So, long story short, I'm growing up bombarded with the fact that black people did not exist in the West. If they existed, it wasn't in a heroic way. They were just servants. That's the omission by omission. You don't see black heroes, you don't believe black heroes exist. That's the whole game of this system. We're gonna show you what we want you to believe. That's the tell of vision. Okay? That's what imagery is all about. That's what how film is propagandistic. How white supremacy persists. Now, what's the reality? The reality is Stagecoach Mary, black woman, fearless, accomplished things that many men couldn't do. She got the mail delivered, went through dangerous territory. Where was the story of Stagecoach Mary? Bass Reeves. Who? Bass Reeves, the most successful lawman in the history of the West. Over 3,000 arrests, killed 14 men. 35 years a lawman, deputy marshal. Many say he's the true Lone Ranger. Let's say, who we didn't get. We didn't get, as I say, Stagecoach Man. We didn't get Bass Reeves. We didn't get Jim Beckworth. Now, you can go to a film called Tomahawk. Van Heflin plays Jim Bridger, a mountain man, who was good friends with James Beckworth. Appropriation, we talk about white appropriation, mm-hmm. Or the elimination, the omission of black heroes. In that film, there's a character named Beckworth. Is it Jim Beckworth? No, they won't even go that far. So they have a white Jack Oakey play a character named Saul Beckworth. And the Beckwith, if anyone knows, they said, well, Beckwith, that really should be Jim Beckwith, right? But it's not a black man. They're having a white man with a last name named Beckwith, and they call him Saul. The little subtle way they pay tribute to the fact that it really is about Jim Beckwith, they do a little scene where Jim Bridger is walking with his good friend, Saul Beckwith, and they're walking away, they're walking, and one of the characters sees the two of them, and he wants to get their attention. So what he says is, he calls Jim Bridger by his first name, Jim, and he calls Beckwith, Saul Beckwith, by his last name, Beckwith.
Jim Beckwith.
So the sound is Jim Beckwith.
Okay. All right, but there was one movie that did show a black hero, Sergeant Rutledge.
What is he? He's playing a Buffalo soldier, okay? If they didn't give you Bass Reeves, if they didn't give you Stagecoach Mary, James Beckwith, Ism Dark, Nate Love, Deadwood Dick, they didn't give you any of that. They couldn't deny the importance of the Buffalo soldiers who rode and protected whites who were coming to settle in the West, protected them from the Indians and bandits, protected the railroad workers that so they could lay tracks, helped build the towns, and couldn't even go into the bars and get a damn drink without being discriminated against, okay? So this history was there. John Ford, he decides to make use of it because, as I said once before, when do we get films with a black hero or a black focus? Reactionary, 60s, militancy. The reality is what's going on. Blacks are protesting against this, protesting against that. We don't see this in film. So they're going to give us, finally, a black Western hero, Woody Strode, who used to take care of John Ford. He and John Ford were very close. He gives Woody Strode the role of Sergeant Rutledge.
I'm Mary Beecher. What did you say your name is?
Rutledge, Braxton Rutledge, 1st Sergeant, 9th Cavalry.
I didn't know they had any color. I mean, are you from Fort Linton?
You see Sergeant Rutledge, and it makes you want to cry. Because rather than show you a film dealing with this stalwart black man fighting and being brave, they turned it into a melodrama about did he rape this white girl and kill a white man. It was more of a courtroom drama than an action drama showing you the exploits of a black man. That's what was disappointing. They didn't feel we could sell a black hero. The only thing we could maybe sell it, in fact, one need only look at the trailer for that film, how it was used to soup up this sexual thing to get people into the audience. It's crap. One of the popular shows was The Rifleman, Chuck Connors. And this guy was fantastic with a rifle. And he could shoot that thing like you think he had a machine gun. When we bought the toy, we saw that there was a little piece that you would bring up on the gun, that when you would do this, the little piece would pull the trigger back. So that was the trick. But anyway, we wanted to be like the Rifleman. We wanted to be like Wild Bill Hickok. All of the heroes white kids, black kids wanted to be, they were white. Sammy Davis Jr., who was very popular as an entertainer, he loved the Westerns. He grew up on Westerns. He became very adept with a gun. He was known for gun twirling and quick draw. And because he was a popular entertainer and there was, well, you know what, maybe it's about time we show a black on some of these shows, because there's a lot of people saying, hey, where are the black people? He makes a guest appearance on The Rifleman. The following week, TV Guide received tons of letters, and they were vicious. And the nature of the letters were, where the hell do you get the idea of a N-I-G-G-E-R cowboy? No such thing. People were appalled at the image of this black cowboy. And there's technology involved. When you watch Sammy on The Rifleman, he did two episodes. The first episode he did, he was a very angry black man who was going out looking to kill people based on the way he was raised and the injustice he suffered. And he didn't like lawmen, because he felt they didn't come to the aid and protection of his father. And he went out looking to kill lawmen. He had that vengeance. The way they have it come in town. Now, you know, the lawman, if you know anything about The Rifleman, Micah Terrence is the lawman who's very good friends with The Rifleman, Chuck Connors' character. Now, there ain't nobody faster than The Rifleman. But when you see what Sammy's character can do and how quick he was, you say, oh my goodness, right? Now how is this gonna work out? Because ultimately what it came down to is Sammy's character had to go up against Chuck Connors' Rifleman. And so they do technology with that. The second time Sammy appears on The Rifleman, they lightened his character. He comes in, he's a boastful black man, enlarging on how good he is with a gun, showing how great he is. He's doing all his gun tricks and twirls, and he gets challenged by someone. And he goes in his room and he's sweating bullets because he knows now someone's calling his bluff. And the only out for him is, even though he's fast, are they gonna show him outdraw this white man, even though he's a villain? Know who's gonna have to save him? The Rifleman. That's the technology, because we're at a point where we still can't show a black man defeating a white man. And remember, it was anathema just seeing a black man in a Western because of the reaction I told you. The image received with people saying no such thing. So, you know, we didn't have the real life heroes that existed in the West. We didn't get them in motion pictures. As time went on, and that was the beauty of the blaxploitation era, we could get the legend of Nigger Charlie, the soul of Nigger Charlie, Boss Nigger. A favorite Western of mine was based on actual historical people, the Exodusters, which was based on the word Exodus, where blacks were moving to Kansas, that whole movement. Buck and the Preacher covered that. That's what Buck and the Preacher was about. And then more recently, Django for me was a great Western. That's the time we live in. Things have changed. But the thing is, there was a film that was due to be released. I saw it. I said, where's this film? They Die by Dawn, I think is the title. And what was unique about what this film promised, it was going to give you a whole pantheon of all these black heroes. And I said, oh, man, Do it.
I'm gonna play for you our first tune. It's called Let's Start What We Have Come Into the Room to Do. Right on. Here goes.
You do know how to make a grand entrance.
I know who you are. The angel who hunts down those who trespass against him with no mercy.
Admit it. I'm lighting it with the blam blams.